Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. We thank you, gracious Heavenly Father, for everything that you are and everything that you do and everything that you say, for you are God Almighty. You're God all by yourself. No one voted you in and no one can vote you out. You are Elyon. You are El Shaddai. You are El Roi, the God who sees. And Lord, here we are asking you to give us vision, asking you to give us wisdom, asking you to give us knowledge, asking you to give us understanding, give us counsel, give us might, the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. Give us the fullness of the Holy Spirit so that we can understand the signs of the times. For without you, we can do nothing, but with you, we can do all things. And so, Lord, as we enter into the courts of heaven, bowing before your throne, asking you to fulfill our petitions, Lord, we pray that you would be glorified. Be glorified and be exalted as you teach us great and mighty things that we do not know, as you open up our understanding, as you give us fresh and new revelation, as you make it plain so that we who receive the vision can run and tell it and write it on tablets so that others can see. And so, Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to open up your word and to have you teach us great and mighty things that you are revealing to us at this very hour. Oh, how we love you and thank you. Praying for the peace of Jerusalem. In the name above all names, we pray and ask it all. Jesus the Messiah. Amen. Well, thank you for coming back to another teaching installment of When the Temple in Heaven is Open, Everything Will Change. And praise the Lord, I was doing some studying today and, you know, God said, make a video. So we have to be obedient to what he tells us to do. And, you know, that's what this faith walk is all about. It's not a cakewalk, but it's a faith walk. And so in this faith walk, when God tells you to do something, you do it, because he says, if you love me, we keep his commandments, and keeping his commandments are those things that he tells you to do. And that's what obedience is all about. Obedience and love go hand in hand. You can't separate the two, because you can say that you love God all you want, but if you don't obey him, you don't really love him. You actually hate him, because when you love someone, you listen to what they tell you to do, and then you do it. Hallelujah. Because he says, those who are justified aren't the hearers, but those who are justified are the doers. We have to be doers of what he tells us to do. Hallelujah. And so in the studies that I was doing today, I was looking at how God continues to open up the word of God because it's alive and living. And I was reading the headlines today about, of course, the culprit who was in the headlines. You know, not talking about the common people. The common people, you know, they're just like me and you. But the leaders who make the decisions. And because these leaders make the decisions, you know, everyone under them are also involved in whatever consequences come. No different than here in America, no different than anywhere in the world. It's the leaders who always make the decisions, and then the common people, they have to deal with the consequences. And so here at the end of the age, God has told us what is going to happen, and we see it playing out right before our eyes. And so today, the big news was that Iran had breached the nuclear deal by crossing the uranium limits. And, you know, I'm pretty sure that they had already long passed the limit, but, you know, they just came out and flat said it today. But, you know, these people in leadership in Iran, they're hell-bent on what is coming, because they have, they're going by what they think is right according to their book, which is from the devil. And so they're playing their part in prophecy. And because we have the truth in the word of God, we see everything playing out just as God said it was leading up to the last days. And so Iran said that it was a threat to America. You know, if Iran is attacked by America, Israel will be destroyed in 30 minutes. And so this is all setting up for what God has already told us. And he told us these things thousands of years ago because he already knows the end from the beginning. And so understanding what Hebrews chapter 4 verse tells us, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. We could understand by going into the word of God and seeing what God has to say for this day and age. You'll see, this word is living, it's alive, it's speaking to us right now in the very situations and the reality that we're dealing with right now. That's how awesome this word is. It spoke to the people in Daniel's day. It spoke to the people in Jeremiah's day. It spoke to the people in Isaiah's day. And yet, because God is the author of it, he could also speak to us through the very same word and have it apply to our modern times, because he knows the end from the beginning. And therefore, when we understand and we rightly apply the word of God through the power of the Holy Spirit, we see everything manifesting according to what God had told us in his word. And so, first and foremost, we see that the trap is being set. Okay, this trap, which God himself said that he set. Okay, Jeremiah chapter 50, verse 24, talking about the destruction of Babylon. Listen, Babylon, for I have set a trap for you. You are caught, for you have fought against the Lord. So this trap that God has set for Babylon is being carried out by Iran. Iran is the one who is being stirred up in order to bring Babylon into this trap, because Babylon, the most proud, the most arrogant, the nation that thinks that she can never be defeated, is being drawn into this trap by God himself, because God specifically says that Babylon has opposed the Lord. Babylon has fought against the Lord. And you don't need a rocket scientist to figure out how Babylon is fighting against the Lord, because Babylon is the one who's in charge of this peace to prosperity, peace plan, dubbed the Trump peace plan, which is carving up the land of Israel, legitimizing the Palestinian people and giving them a Palestinian state, and opening up the land that God had given to Israel, to the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob forever as an everlasting possession, to people who the land does not belong to. And Babylon is in charge, okay? Babylon is in charge, and the land of Babylon and the leaders of Babylon is going to pay dearly, because they are in direct opposition against the will of God. Okay, because they are dealing with the apple of his eye. And so God is setting this trap for Babylon, because now it's the final straw. Okay, God has given Babylon warning after warning after warning after warning. Every time Babylon has done something, talking about modern day Babylon, Babylon the Great, every time Babylon the Great has done something to Israel, God has sent judgment upon Babylon the Great. And God is going to finally end it. Okay, and we know that this ending happens when everything goes down, what we know as the day of sudden destruction. Okay, the day that comes like a thief in the night, which is the day of the Lord. The day when, first and foremost, the rapture occurs, which will be the next event. The next event, this next worldwide event, is going to catch the world off guard. But for people like me and you, the body of Christ, we're going to be caught up, instantaneous, snatched out. And right after we get snatched out, the destruction is going to come suddenly, swift, fast, and in a hurry. And the world is going to be devastated. It's not going to know what happened. Okay. And many people are going to die from the day of sudden destruction. And so God is telling us how this day is playing out. And so, as I just mentioned, the two events, the three entities are all in play: Iran, Israel, and America. Okay, because Iran is the Medes, okay? In the Bible, they're known as the Medes, they're known as the Persians, and they're known as Elam. And so modern-day Iran, going by their ancient biblical names, God says this about the trap that he springs for Babylon. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 11. Sharpen the arrows. Make bright the arrows, the King James Bible says. Take up the shields. The Lord has stirred up the spirit of the kings of the Medes, because his purpose concerning Babylon is to destroy it. For that is the vengeance of the Lord, the vengeance of his temple. Okay, so we see that God is saying that he's stirring up the kings of the Medes, the spirit of the kings of the Medes. Okay, so he's using the spirit of the kings of the Medes in order to set this trap, to lay this snare for Babylon and catch Babylon by surprise before she even figures it out. Okay, because Babylon is the most arrogant. She's the most mighty. She's the most proud. She doesn't know that she's being led headlong into this trap. Because when you come against Iran, you're not just coming against Iran. Okay, it's the oh my goodness, it's the ones who've been laying in the cut, waiting for this day for a long time. And you don't even need a PhD to understand who I'm talking about. We're talking about the bear, okay? We're talking about the kings of the east, okay? We're talking about the nations from the north, okay? All those who are in line with Iran. And is it just a coincidence that Babylon continues to provoke, that continues to poke at Russia, that continues to poke at China, okay? And then you see Babylon thinks that she's on good footing, because now they're deceived because North Korea is in the mix. And now Babylon thinks that North Korea is friendly, but no, it's a trap. It's a trap, my friends. It's a trap, okay? We got to understand what God says, okay? It's a trap. When you're caught in the trap, you don't know it. You don't know it. That's why it's called a trap, okay? You're walking along one day, and then all of a sudden, you step on a bear claw, and it snaps on your foot. You never saw it coming. Oh, but when it snaps on your foot, oh, you better, it's, okay, it's over. Okay, your foot's gone. Okay, it's no different with this, because this is what's coming. Okay, Babylon is going headlong into this trap. And this trap is about to be sprung, because we can see that the rhetoric continues to intensify. Because once God gives the go-ahead, and that go-ahead will be the rapture, because the restrainer is going to be removed. Hallelujah. We're going to be taken out of here. Hallelujah. The Bible says when the go-ahead is given, hallelujah, everything is going to fall. The biggest domino will be Babylon the Great. But then you got Gog and Magog as well. They're going to be dealt with. Then you got the destruction of Damascus. They're going to be dealt with. And then you got the greatest earthquake in human history that's going to move every island and every mountain out of its place. Then you got the hailstones and coals of fire that are going to pummel the earth. Okay? It's the cloudy day. Okay? And so we see in the book of Daniel exactly what we see playing out with Iran. Because remember, here in Daniel chapter 10, Daniel was praying for 21 days. And when he has set his face to pray, God says that he had heard his voice. He had heard the words of his prayer. But then when the word was sent back to Daniel to make him understand the vision, the angel who was sent to give him the answer, he was held up by the king of Persia. Let's pick up, because you see, the king of Persia, the spirit of the Persians, the spirit of the Medes are stirring up right now, and they're standing in the way of Israel. They're standing in the way of Israel receiving the vision, the understanding for the time of Jacob's trouble. The blinders are still on their eyes. And so Iran is standing in the way. Just like in Daniel chapter 10, the prince of Persia was in the way. And as long as the prince of Persia was in the way, the vision for the understanding of the latter days could not be received and understood. Likewise, in our days and in age, Iran is standing in the way of Israel, understanding that Jesus is the Messiah. Because as long as Iran is standing in the way, the time of Jacob's trouble will not commence. It's not until Iran is taken out of the way on the day of sudden destruction, when they come against Israel and Gog and Magog. It's only then that the time of Jacob's trouble begins. And look at how Daniel just paints this picture. Oh, it's a wonderful picture. Look at this. Daniel chapter 10, verse 10. And behold, a hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon the palms of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto you and stand upright. For unto you am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I am come for your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. Okay, so this word that this angel was to give Daniel, it was a word concerning the latter days. Okay, verse 14, I'm just going to jump down here so you can see this right quick. Now I am come to make you understand what shall befall your people in the latter days, for yet the vision is for many days. So when Daniel was fasting and praying for 21 days, God said that immediately he had heard his word and he had sent the answer through this angel. And so when the angel was coming down to give Daniel the answer, the kingdom of Persia, the prince of the kingdom of Persia, was standing in his way. And it's the same thing today. The spirit of the kings of the Medes, okay, and the principality, that spiritual wickedness that is behind these governmental leaders, that's behind the nation of Iran. They're again standing in the way for the latter day vision to be fulfilled, because the latter day vision that has to be fulfilled is the time of Jacob's trouble. It's the time of Jacob's trouble. Okay. And the kingdom of Persia is again standing in the way. But look what happens. Look what happens. It's the same thing. It's the same story. It's just so amazing. You can't make this up unless you're God. Only God could write this, because he says the same thing from the beginning, even at the end. Look what happens. Verse 13, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me. You see, it's only when Michael stands up. It's when Michael stands up. Okay. When Michael stands up, it's going to break through. Hallelujah. And we know when Michael stands up. We know when Michael stands up. Because when Michael stands up, it's the war in heaven. Okay. Revelation chapter 12. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Hallelujah. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. Hallelujah. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Oh, when he's cast out, look at what he tries to do when he's cast out. Revelation chapter 12, verse 3, and there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads. Verse 4, and his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Oh, but God, he always wins. Verse 5, here's our blessed hope. And she brought forth a man-child. Hallelujah. Who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up, harpazo, raptured unto God and to his throne. It's the bang bang event. It's the cloudy day, my friends. It's the day of our redemption, the day when God will bring us into the large place. You see, and as we go up, here comes the dragon and all his angels coming down. They're going to try to stand before us, but he can't get to us. Hallelujah. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Hallelujah. And God snatches us out. We're caught up unto God as the devil and all of his angels, as they're getting their butt kicked by Michael and all the good angels. They're coming down and we're going up. Hallelujah. They try to stand before us, but they can't get us. Hallelujah. Because we belong to God. We're covered by the blood. The year of his redeemed has come. Hallelujah. You see, and so we see a perfect picture of what we see in Daniel and what we see in our day. The spirit of the kings of the Medes are standing up against the vision being fulfilled in regards to the latter days, which is the time of Jacob's trouble. And so the only way for Israel to finally understand is for Michael to stand up. Michael has to stand up. Michael has to stand up because Michael is the one who fights on behalf of Israel. And we know that when Michael stands up, it's also the rapture. Here we see Michael stand up, Revelation chapter 10. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven. Oh, he's victorious. Hallelujah. He kicks the devil's butt. Hallelujah. Clothed with a cloud. It's the cloudy day, my friends. And a rainbow was upon his head. Oh, but there's someone greater than Michael. There's a rainbow upon his head. And the rainbow surrounds the throne of God. And his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. So we see that Jesus is above him. Jesus is on the cloud, okay? Jesus is on the cloud, and because the Ark of the Covenant is his chariot and his throne, the rainbow is around his throne. Hallelujah. And when Jesus himself comes down on the clouds, hallelujah, he's coming down at the same time that Michael stands up. Hallelujah. And when he comes down on the cloud at the same time that Michael stands up, the body of Christ is going to be raptured into the Father's house. Hallelujah. And when we are raptured into the Father's house, we escape from the time of trouble. We escape from the time of trouble. Hallelujah. Because the time of trouble is when Israel will finally get the message. This message that concerns the people of Israel in regards to the latter days. Okay. Again, the kings of Persia are trying to stand before the children of Israel, receiving the final message that concerns them in the latter days. Is playing out just like it did in Daniel's day. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. There's nothing new done under the sun. But as we saw here in Daniel 10, when Michael stands up, the message will be received. Hallelujah. But you see, this message about the latter days is the time of Jacob's trouble. And then as we see here in Daniel chapter 11, we get into the time of Jacob's trouble. Right before, we see something interesting. Because remember, Babylon the Great is also involved. And Babylon the Great has to tumble. Look at this in Daniel chapter 11, verse 1. Remember, the Bible speaking to us right now. It's alive. It's living. As we understand the overall prophetic picture of God, we can understand what he's talking about. So may he minister to you as we go over this. Daniel chapter 11, verse 1. And in the first year of Darius the Mede, even I stood to confirm and to strengthen him. And now will I show you the truth. Behold, there shall stand up yet three kings in Persia, and the fourth shall be far richer than they all. And by his strength, through his riches, he shall stir up all against the realm of Grecia. The realm of Grecia is hinting at Babylon the Great, the West. Okay, we know that when this was fulfilled in Daniel's day, it was talking about the kingdom of Persia that was destroyed by Alexander the Great, the first king of Greece. But because the word of God is alive, don't let the devil deceive you, okay? This word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, okay? The word of God is alive. Therefore, it's speaking to us today. It's speaking to us in our days, okay? So God is telling us something for us. And when you understand the total prophetic picture of the plan of God, you can see how he's speaking to us right now. Because the kings of Persia are again stirring up all against the realm of Greece. The realm of Greece is talking about Babylon the Great, because Babylon the Great is the final fulfillment of that Grecian Empire. Remember, that Grecian Empire is talked about in Daniel chapter 7. It's the leopard kingdom that had four heads and four wings of a fowl. Okay, it had four heads and four wings of a fowl because it spread to the four corners of the earth. The Western civilization, the Western culture, it started with Greece, which was the first king. Okay, Alexander the Great, and he conquered all the known world. And then his kingdom was broken up at his death, and it was broken up amongst his four generals. And his four generals split up the kingdom into four different parts, and that kingdom spread to the four corners of the world. Okay, it spread to Rome, and then it continued toward the west, and it finds its final fulfillment in modern day Babylon the Great, which will be the end of the Grecian Empire. Okay, and the end of the Grecian Empire is being brought about by the kingdom of Persia. Okay, because the kingdom of Persia, as it says in Daniel chapter 11, the kingdom of Persia is going to stir up all against the realm of Greece. We know they're talking about Russia, the kings of the north, China, Turkey, North Korea, and many people with them, okay? Many people with them are being stirred up. America is going to be brought down because it's led into a trap that she doesn't even know. But look at this. Look at the detail that God gives us in Daniel chapter 11, verse 3. Okay. And a mighty king shall stand up. I believe that's Donald Trump. Look at the description. Because, okay, we know that in the original context, this mighty king was Alexander the Great. But it's also speaking to our time. Because look at how this prophecy goes. Daniel chapter 11, verse 3, and a mighty king shall stand up that shall rule with great dominion and do according to his will. Okay, that's Donald Trump. He's doing whatever he wants to do, and he's ruling with great dominion. And then look, verse 4, and when he shall stand up, okay, he's the president right now, his kingdom shall be broken. Okay, it's the end of Babylon the Great, and shall be divided toward the four winds of heaven. Okay, it's the cloudy day when the four winds are released. And look at this, and not to his posterity, nor according to his dominion, which he ruled, for his kingdom shall be plucked up even for others beside those. Okay, so this kingdom that's going to be plucked up and given not to his posterity, nor will it ever be ruled again according to his dominion. This is the end of Babylon the Great. It's the end of his kingdom. Okay. When he stands up. Okay. When he stands up. It's the end. And I believe that mighty king is Donald Trump, the seventh king in Revelation chapter 17, the seventh king who only rules for a short time, because after the seventh king, the eighth king comes. Let me just show you this right quick so you can see this, because there's still more I want to show you. I want to show you this because look at how God is just so precise. God is just so precise. Look at this. Revelation chapter 17, okay, the seventh king of Babylon the Great, which is Donald Trump. Okay, we already know, well, if you don't know, the number seven is all connected to Donald Trump. And so we see that this seventh king only continues for a short time. Revelation chapter 17, verse 10. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. Okay, so that seventh king had not came at the time when John was writing the vision. And John said that when he comes, he's only going to continue for a short space. I believe that seventh king is Donald Trump, because the number seven is all connected to that man. And it goes so deep. And I've done plenty of studies on that, but I don't want to get into that study right now. But that seventh king that only continues for a short time is identified again right here in Daniel chapter 11, verse 3, when a mighty king stands up that shall rule with great dominion and do according to his will. And when he stands up, his kingdom will be broken. Because here in Revelation chapter 17, after this seventh king appears, and he only continues for a short time, there comes an eighth king, which is the Antichrist. Revelation chapter 17, verse 11. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goes into perdition. Okay, so there's another king that comes after, and that eighth king is the Antichrist. And we see this here, because look in Daniel chapter 11, after this seventh king is defeated, after this seventh king, well, Daniel chapter 11, verse 3 doesn't call him the seventh king. He calls him the mighty king. Once he stands up and his kingdom is broken and divided up toward the four winds of heaven, that's when the four winds are released. Okay, it's all on that same cloudy day, that day of sudden destruction. Look who appears. Then as we continue in Daniel chapter 11, then the kings are mentioned. And these kings who are mentioned represent the 10 kings, specifically the three kings who are going to be uprooted when the Antichrist takes over. Because remember, when the Antichrist takes over, there's 10 kings who appear at first. Revelation chapter 17, verse 12. And the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Okay, so there's 10 kings who are coming. And here in Daniel chapter 11, after it talks about the overthrow of Babylon the Great, the next event that happens will be the time of Jacob's trouble. And the time of Jacob's trouble begins with the rule of the 10 kings. And here specifically in Daniel chapter 11, we see the overthrow of three of the kings. Because in Daniel chapter 7, it tells us that there's going to be three kings who are going to be uprooted. Three of the 10 kings are going to be uprooted, and then the beast is going to rule with all the power. Okay, Daniel chapter 7, verse 7. After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Verse 8, here's the key. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things. So, when this fourth beast kingdom takes over, which it takes over after the destruction of Babylon the Great, which happens on the cloudy day, which happens when the day of the Lord begins, which is when the rapture happens. If you're left behind, the fourth beast kingdom will take over. And with that fourth beast kingdom that takes over, there's going to be 10 kings. And so here we see the mention of the kings. And here in Daniel chapter 11, we see the mention of the fall of three kings. Okay, there's three kings who fall. Just like Daniel chapter 7 says that there's going to be three horns plucked up, and the horns are the kings. So when these three horns, which are the three kings, are plucked up, then the little horn appears. And it's exactly what we see here in Daniel chapter 11. Here goes the plucking up of one horn. Daniel chapter 11, verse 5. And the king of the south shall be strong, and one of his princes, and he shall be strong above him and have dominion. His dominion shall be a great dominion. And in the end of years, they shall join themselves together. For the king's daughter of the south shall come to the king of the north to make an agreement. But she shall not retain the power of the arm, neither shall he stand, nor his arm, but she shall be given up. And they that brought her, and he that begat her, and he that strengthened her in these times. So there goes the downing of the king of the south. So there's one king down, okay? Because verse 7 tells us, but out of a branch of her roots shall one stand up in his estate, which shall come with an army, okay? So that first king is dead, okay? And that's one king that's down. So let's drop down here to see the fall of the next two kings. Daniel chapter 11, we'll just start at verse 14. And in those times there shall stand up against the king of the south also the robbers of your people shall exalt themselves to establish the vision, but they shall fall. So the king of the north shall come and cast up a mount and take the most fenced cities, and the arms of the south shall not withstand, neither his chosen people, neither shall there be any strength to withstand. But he that cometh against him shall do according to his own will, and none shall stand before him. And he shall stand in the glorious land which by his hand shall be consumed. He shall also set his face to enter with the strength of his whole kingdom and upright ones with him. Thus shall he do, and he shall give him the daughter of women, corrupting her. But she shall not stand on his side, neither before him. After this shall he turn his face unto the isles, and shall take many. But a prince for his own behalf shall cause the reproach offered by him to cease. Without his own reproach he shall cause it to turn upon him. Then he shall turn his face toward the fort of his own land, but he shall stumble and fall and not be found. Okay, so that's the death of another king. So that's two kings down. Okay, two kings are dead now. Okay, so here goes the death of the third king. Verse 20. Then shall stand up in his estate a raiser of taxes in the glory of the kingdom, but within few days he shall be destroyed, neither in anger nor in battle. So here we got the death of the three kings. Okay, you see how the word of God is just so precise? Three kings die. Okay, and then right after these three kings are uprooted, look who appears. Here comes the beast, the Antichrist. Verse 21, and in his estate shall stand up a vile person. It's a terrible day. To whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom. But he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flattery. Oh, the Bible says by peace he shall destroy many. Oh, it's a terrible day. Verse 22. And with the arms of a flood shall they be overthrown before him, and shall be broken, yea, also the prince of the covenant. And after the league made with him, oh, it's that covenant of death. He's going to enter into a covenant with many. It's the evil plan. Oh, it's treachery. It's the covenant of death. Oh, look at this. Verse 23. And after the league made with him, he shall work deceitfully. Oh, he's going to make that covenant with many. Oh, but it's going to be peace, supposedly. And for he shall come up and shall become strong with the small people. Oh, You see, he's going to start off small, but then, because it's the devil incarnate, he's going to trample over everyone. Okay, he's going to trample over everyone. Okay, and so I don't want to, you can continue to read it, but as you can see, it goes according to the script. Okay, according to the script, Daniel chapter 7, there's 10 kings in the fourth beast kingdom. Three of the first horns are plucked up, and then the Antichrist appears. Daniel chapter 11, we saw the death of three kings after the destruction of Babylon the Great. Once the kings of Persia are stirring up everyone to come against Babylon the Great, the trap. And then Babylon the Great is destroyed. Okay, and right after Babylon the Great is destroyed, then here comes the 10 kings. And specifically, we get the mention of the death of three of the 10 kings. And right after the death of the three of the 10 kings, right after verse 21, and onwards, then you got the Antichrist, the vile person. Okay, you can't make it up even if you tried. This is the script. This is the script, and this is what's going to happen. There's no ands, ifs, or buts about it. This is what's going to happen. It's the plan of God. The only question is, do you see? Do you understand? Can you have discernment about what God is doing in these final moments? Okay, and we see it's all going down. Okay, Iran is the trap, and America is being led right into it. It's no one else but America who's being led into this trap. Okay, and of course, Israel, but we already know the outcome. At the same time that America is destroyed, they're going to try to attack Israel, but at the same time, God comes on the clouds, and he wipes them all out, Gog and Magog. Okay. All you got to do is look at the destruction in Ezekiel 38. He does it with the greatest earthquake in human history. Okay. And he does it with hailstones and coals of fire. It's the same event that you read in Revelation chapter 11. When the temple in heaven is open, the greatest earthquake in human history and hailstones and coals of fire. It's all that same day of sudden destruction, which the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that we, talking about the body of Christ, are going to escape. But everyone who's left behind, they will not escape. Okay, they're caught in that time of sudden destruction. They're caught. And if you are trampled on the threshing floor, when God tramples this earth, okay, when he comes through marching victoriously on the clouds, okay, if you're caught up in that destruction, well, you're going to go to hell. That's the fourth rider. Okay, but if you survive, oh my goodness, if you survive, you receive grace and you receive mercy, because God is going to give you one last chance. And that one last chance to get it right is the time of Jacob's trouble. But it's going to be the worst time in human history. Therefore, come to Jesus today. Accept him as your Lord and Savior today. Call upon his name and cry out for a Savior, because he loves you. All you have to do is confess with your mouth that he is Lord and believe in your heart that he rose from the dead and you'll be saved. Simple as that. But the choice is yours, you know. He's never going to force you to love him. He's never going to force you to accept him. But he says, you choose. You choose this day. Choose this day whom you will serve. Life or death, blessing or cursing, heaven or hell. The time is running out, my friends, as you can see. The trap is about to be sprung. But the Bible tells us that at such an hour as we think not, the Son of Man will come. Therefore, if you would have watched at what hour the thief was coming, you would not have allowed your house to be broken into. Therefore, watch and pray always, so that we can be accounted worthy to escape all the things that are about to come on the earth and stand before the Son of Man. For surely he comes quickly. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. Amen.